you had this shot heard around the world to take us back to Wittenberg and bring us into the present of people saying, wait a minute, I don't need a Catholic priest to absolve me of my sins. I don't trust a Catholic priest with my kids. I don't trust a Catholic priest to pray my dead father out of purgatory. All I need is the Bible in my language, and I'm going to go straight to the throne of God by myself. That is revolutionary. It's exactly what it was. The Protestant Reformation, the shot heard around the world, the most dangerous thing that happened to this system of control by religion in 1517. And as a result of this, you had a what is now known as the Counter-Reformation. We had a young Basque, Spanish Basque noble named Ignacio Lopez. And he was a prince and was involved in the wars between Spain and France. And Pamplona, in the Battle of Pamplona, his leg was shattered by cannonball. And so his dreams of glory and martial accomplishments were shattered. And as a result, he was devastated. He could no longer be a soldier, but he was extremely focused and dedicated and wanted that life. He pulled himself into contemplation and believed that he had a vision of the Virgin Mary, and took this vision to monks in Montserrat and prostrated himself before what is known as the Black Virgin of Montserrat. Now, again, not to offend our Catholic brothers and sisters, but a lot of this iconography can trace itself back to the worship of Isis and Semiramis. Mm-hmm. When you watch a movie and you see the goddess Columbia come up, she looks like the Statue of Liberty.
Right.
That's the same person, Isis Semiramis, the goddess of wisdom.
Columbia Pictures.
Absolutely. You've got the globe of Universal Pictures, and you've got the goddess of wisdom in Columbia and Columbia Pictures.
District of Columbia.
Yeah, that's exactly what that's all about.
Yeah,
it's about worship of the goddess of wisdom and reason. And this goes back to this legend of Nimrod. And this legend was retranslated into Osiris and Isis, of this great rebel that was going to lead people against the oppression of God and build this first great empire. Build the Tower of Babel, reach to the sky, which now, if we consider this flat Earth paradigm, maybe reach to the top of the dome. Who knows? But we have this legend of this first great, powerful rebel leader, who, according to legend, was eventually captured and judged by a son of Noah. It was Shem was the son who was, by legend, captured Nimrod and executed him for apostasy and cut him into pieces as a warning against all future apostates, scatter them on the waters. The legend varies based on who's telling it. Poor Osiris was captured by his brother Set, the evil brother Set. You see the similarities there.
Right.
Set was the bad guy, versus the previous legend where Shem was the good guy. Now we've reversed the roles. Osiris is the good guy. Set is the evil brother. Murdered his brother Osiris, cut him into pieces, and scattered him across the Nile. Well, his dutiful and loyal wife, Semiramis, was the dutiful and loyal wife of Nimrod. Isis was the dutiful and loyal wife of Osiris. Tried to put his pieces back together because she really missed her husband. Unfortunately for her, she couldn't find his private parts.
Look out.
I'm not making this up.
Oh, I know.
So the part depends on the legend. One legend says that the fish god Dagon found his parts and brought them to her. Another legend says that she created them herself. The bottom line is we have this queen who had a pregnancy, and she wanted to explain this pregnancy by a miraculous interaction.
Right.
And so this is supposedly what this interaction is. And the result was the birth of a messianic child. For the Nimrod Semiramis connection, that child was Tammuz, who was supposedly a reincarnation of Nimrod. For the Egyptian version, it's Horus. Horus was a reincarnation of his father, Osiris, and he went to avenge himself of his father's murder by battling Set, and there's all kinds of weird things that happen there. Mm-hmm. But this is where all that legend comes from. And so when Ignacio Lopez has this vision of Mary, the Queen of Heaven, you know, we question, is this really Mary, the mother of Jesus, or this is this a different Mary? Is this someone that traces her lineage all the way back to Isis and Semiramis? And right. So this is the vision he had. He retreated into a cave, and hey, much the same way as Muhammad did. And he had visions in the cave, and he came up with spiritual disciplines. He starved himself. He punished himself. He wanted to rid himself of his sins. And he came up with the idea of destroying this fledgling Protestant Reformation on behalf of the Pope and winning back the Holy Land in Jerusalem, also for the Pope. So he was going to start this new movement called the Knights of the Virgin Mary.
Mm-hmm.
And so he brought this, first he acted on this movement. He ended up going to Paris in France to learn Latin so that he could further himself in this endeavor. And he connected with some young men that joined him, Francis Xavier for one, Peter Faber, the fathers of the Jesuit movement. Of course, at this time, it was the Knights of the Virgin Mary. So this is 1534, and so they have these very die-hard religious, fanatics that were going to put the papacy back in her seat of world control. This was brought before the Pope, and 6 years later, in 1540, the Pope said, hey, you got it, go. We're going to make one change. We're going to take the accent off of Mary, and we're going to put it on Jesus. It's going to be much more palatable that way. And we're going to call you the Society of Jesus. Later, it was a slang term that this new society would be called Jesuits, because what do you call it when you put two words together? It's an amalgam of two words.
Amalgamation.
Yeah, an amalgamation of Jesuita. Are you Jesus-like? And it was meant to be an insult because the Jesuits had become so cutthroat. Oh, my goodness. Go online and read the fourth and final blood oath of the Jesuit order. It will curl your toes.
Right. I wanted to ask you about that. What can you tell us about the Jesuits, not only their oath, but some of the rituals they partake in before they join their order?
We don't know anything firsthand. What we do have is the testimony of ex-Jesuits like Alberto Rivera, who I think he's convincing. Look, it's a personal decision whether or not you look at him and what he said as a whole and said, okay, this guy's believable, where he says that the Jesuit, and by the way, he's not the only source for what goes on in this final vow, where you hold a dagger by the blade to your chest, and you also hold a black crucifix, and you make this blood-curdling vow to serve the Pope, to literally rip open the stomachs of women, to use the poison cup, to use the strangulation cord, the point of the poniard, or the leaden ball, to murder, to exploit the confessional, to regicide, to kill kings who aren't following the line in order to bring back the supremacy of the Pope. This is what is reputed to be behind the Jesuit order, the Counter-Reformation.
Makes sense given their background.
And I will tell you, and here's an historical fact that makes you think there might be something to this. The Jesuits go all around the world. They are extremely dedicated to their order, their oath, and to the supremacy of Roman Catholicism. And wouldn't you know it, Greg, that the Jesuits have been kicked out of every single country they've been in. I mean, from the very top, kings and presidents around the world have kicked the Jesuits out. Why? Because they've been implicated in assassinations and subterfuge and treason.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard you mention this in previous interviews, and I had a question for you on that. What you had just said about the Jesuits being kicked out of every major place, that's exactly what researchers who try to place the Jews at the top of the pyramid cite as a historical pattern, and they'll tell you that it's because they keep getting caught trying to subvert populations from within, exactly what you're saying. So I'm interested in what you think about this idea, because it is quite popular in the alternative realm.
And there's a reason why it's popular. It's put there by these forces that we're talking about. This goes back all the way out to the Crusades. As a result of the Crusades, you had the sovereign military order of, well, they eventually were known as the Templars. And the Templars were a very powerful order of knights that led were the tip of the spear for the Crusades. They were the poor fellow soldiers of Christ of the Temple of Solomon. And the Order of Solomon's Temple is another name of the Templars. As a result of what they did in the Holy Land, going through Jerusalem, win Jerusalem back for the Pope, they became exceptionally powerful and rich. They were endorsed by the Catholic Church in 1129. And so they were very, very favored by the papacy. And as a result of their riches, do you know the Templars came up with our modern banking system?
Right.
They are responsible for modern usury, interest-based banking. Not the Jews, the Templars. And as a result of this, with their power, you had concerns among some very ambitious kings around the world, in particular King Philip IV of France, where he exploited the same accusations against the Jesuits were there against the Templars. And I'll tell you, Greg, this stuff gets creepy because you see this continuity of these secret societies. They're all accused of black magic, demon worship, severe perverse sexual rites, sacrifice in these rites of humans and babies. And so you had these accusations going against the Templars. And as a result, they were strong enough for King Philip to make the case that Pope Clement V disbanded the order. And this was commanded in, it began to take effect in 1307. And it precipitated the events of Black Friday, Friday the 13th, October 13th in 1307, where the leader of the Templars at the time, de Molay, many of his knights were rounded up, tortured for political purposes, political reasons, because they had information and intelligence that was useful to France. But really had very little. So you see how this issue of ethics was exploited, morality. Hey, these guys are immoral, but you know what? I'm going to torture them for political secrets. So they were treated very poorly, whether they deserved it or not. The incident was exploited as a result. Many Templars went underground. They realized that, hey, we can never put our names and our faces to our machinations ever again. We need a scapegoat. And since that time, the Jews have been a phenomenal scapegoat, sadly, because so many of them have been willing scapegoats. They have been empowered by these forces. There is a phenomenal book by a Jew, if I can remember it. It's The Rockefellers and the Federal Reserve, Their Gold Standard, something along those lines. And it is a phenomenal tell-all book that explains how the papacy exploited Jews, used them as the front men for banking, and when it was expedient, killed them, burned them at the stake. That's an historical fact, and that's why the Jews were the butt of many Inquisition investigations, is because that began their exploitation. Oh my goodness. Let's talk about the Hegelian dialectic and how the Jesuits and Roman Catholicism owned both fascism and communism. Go to the rise of Adolf Hitler. Do you know that Adolf Hitler's, the book that put him on the map, Mein Kampf, Did you know it wasn't really written by him? It was written by a Jesuit.
Yeah, I learned that from your book, actually. You refer to Hitler as a Jesuit puppet.
Bernard Stamfel. This is something anyone can look up. Now, he rewrote. He proofread it. Brother, he wrote the darn thing. Adolf Hitler was damn near illiterate, pardon my French. And as a result, Bernard Stamfel wrote Mein Kampf for him. Franz von Papen was a Catholic aristocrat, bankrolled the Third Reich, would never have existed. Oh, my goodness. The Pope, Pius XII, Eugenio Pacelli, prior to, I think, in the 30s, he was the papal legate. He was the Vatican, London, and Washington, D.C. are sovereign city-states. Their rules are, they have separate rules and laws. They are literally sovereign city-states. Therefore, the Vatican has an ambassador. And Eugenio Pacelli was the papal ambassador to Germany in this critical time. And surprise, surprise, he later becomes Pope Pius XII. He's known among circles because of the Vatican rat lines that helped pull the Nazis out of World War II as the Allies were closing in. As Hitler's Pope, it's the other way around, Greg. Mm-hmm. Hitler was Pacelli's puppet. So Himmler, look at the connections, the Jesuit connections with Himmler. Mm-hmm. Hitler himself is credited as having said, I patterned the SS after the Jesuits because of their loyalty. And then you go to the other side of the coin, communism. These two sides of the Hegelian dialectic talk about fear of porn, to make good people be afraid for their lives. The fascists are coming. The communists are coming. Communism, the idea of communal ownership of property, goes back to Thomas Aquinas, a great Catholic theologian, writing about the communal ownership of property. Well, it took the Jesuits to put this into practice in the reductionist settlements in South America, where they basically enslaved good Indian peoples in South America, in Paraguay and Brazil and Argentina, and bled these poor Indians dry and sent their funds back to Portugal and Spain, good Catholic countries. And they put this communism into practice to the point where they were able to perfect it. And again, we have to rely on an ex-Jesuit insider, Alberto Rivera. But what Alberto Rivera says fits with historically accepted fact. Karl Marx, again, a Jew, picked as a Jew to be the puppet and the face of communism. Where did Karl Marx come from? Where did he go to come up with the tenets of communism? Where did he write the manifesto? Do you know he did it in a private reading room in the British Museum? Why are you going to go in a private reading room in the British Museum to come up with the tenets of communism? He did that, Alberto Rivera says, because they were secretly being spoon-fed to him by the Jesuits who own communism. So you have this Hegelian dialectic of thesis, antithesis, synthesis. So you have people that have rights. Let's just talk about modern America. The Bill of Rights says, for the first time in human history, we're going to do away the feudalism. We're going to allow a middle class, unheard of, to own property and defend it with a weapon. Absolutely unheard of. How do you get those people to give up those rights? Freedom of speech, the ability to own property and defend it with a weapon from whatever threat, your own government if necessary. You get them to give that up by scaring them with Al-Qaeda or ISIS. What self-respecting jihadi would contort the name of his organization so that it would create the acronym ISIS? Are you kidding me? It was so bloody obvious, Greg, that they had to muddy the waters. Oh, it's not ISIS. It's ISIL. It's IS.
Right.
Because it was that obvious that Freemasonic insiders had created ISIS, like they created Al-Qaeda and good Polish Catholics of Zbigniew Brzezinski, Jimmy Carter's handler and national security advisor, who most of us agree in this community created Al-Qaeda. There's a picture that floats around the internet which looks pretty much a lot like Osama bin Laden, whose CIA code name was Tim Osman, standing there with Zbigniew Brzezinski, still alive, Greg, as an advisor to our current president, Barack Obama.
Damn.
So the Jews are, for the most part, a smokescreen that is put up by these Jesuit forces to hide behind, because nothing gets you better. Look, we have to be scientists. Names, places, dates, things you can verify yourself. What gets you to lose your mind any better than mindless racial hatred? It's the Jews. Right. It's the Zionists.
Right.
It gets you to disconnect your brain. Wait a minute. Step back. Look at it. Is there a purpose in the creation of Israel? Yes, to distract you, to create constant chaos, to make you focus on Jerusalem and not Rome. And that's exactly what we have today.
That's interesting, man. You're making some great points. And in your book, the way you say this is, to quote it, the Jesuits have a powerful apparatus. They shield the elite from view behind the Star of David and attack their enemies with the sword of Muhammad. And that's pretty poetic, man. But as far as the Jewish thing goes, this is something that I've had a problem with, or, you know, had a hard time reconciling, because the Rothschilds, from what I understand, built their wealth outside of the Catholic Church. And I read this book called God's Bankers by Gerald Posner, and he talked about some instances where the Vatican was nearly broke and needed to be bailed out by the Rothschilds. Here's a quick quote. He said, "Although the aristocratic Pope Pius was an unrepentant advocate of the medieval view of the Jews as the evil architects of everything from rationalism to Freemasonry to socialism, he reluctantly agreed that only the Rothschilds could keep the church afloat. The new Rothschild loan was 50 million francs, more than $10 million. That was more than the Vatican's entire budget for a year, and two additional loans were soon forthcoming, totaling another 54 million francs." And I don't know if that's true or not. Of course, I haven't. I mean, that's what he says. But to me, that almost sounds like the Rothschilds bought the Vatican.
Yeah, it's actually the other way around, Greg. Rothschild means red shield. What army used to use red shields? The Roman army.
Yeah.
The Rothschilds, the legend goes for the Rothschilds, is that it was at Waterloo that they were given inside information about who was the winner of the Battle of Waterloo. Well, if that's accurate, and Napoleon's downfall was leaked to the Rothschilds, then I got news for you. It's clearly Rome. Because Napoleon Bonaparte was absolutely a puppet of the papacy, a Jesuit-trained Catholic priest named Emmanuel Sias. Abbey Sias, Father Sias, had whispered in Napoleon's ear the entire time to get him to react according to the way the Jesuits wanted him. Do you know that Napoleon actually conquered Rome and imprisoned the Pope? I believe it was Pius VI that he imprisoned. The Jesuits, as a result of their machinations around the world, had upset even Catholic nations to the point where everyone around the world were telling the Pope, listen to me, you better do something about these Jesuits or we're done and you're done. And as a result, now some people question whether this was done legitimately or not, or was all a show and done underground. The Jesuits were suppressed. And this was in, I believe, a papal bull of 1773. Clement the 13th was about to sign this papal bull, and he was assassinated. He died. Clement the 14th did sign a papal bull, and he is reputed to have died so horribly that his body began to decay before he perished.
Shit.
His tongue began to dry up inside his mouth. His body was so deformed they could not present him in state to Catholic followers.
Good God.
So later, you have the suppression of the Jesuits. Jesuits had disappeared. They didn't exist anymore. Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. Just like the Templars, who carry on the Jesuit name. But the other way around, the Jesuits carry on the Templar tradition. They went underground for a very, very short period of time, 73. Okay, so you had Napoleon in, I believe it was 1798, conquered the papacy, appeared to conquer the Vatican.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, he imprisoned Pius VI, who supposedly apparently died 6 weeks later in prison. They very quickly coronated Pius VII, and boy, Pius VII got the message. Greg, Pius VII reinstituted the Jesuit order in 1814. And there's a fascinating letter that I reference between Jefferson and John Adams about how they are very concerned about the reinstitution of the Jesuit order.
Right.
And then they appear to be a victim of their own ideals, their own Enlightenment ideals. Well, hey, look, it's universalism. These are just priests, so we have to keep America open to these guys. They're not priests, they're insurgents. That's where they went wrong. And I firmly believe that Adams, John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, and James Monroe paid for their James Monroe and the Monroe Doctrine, tried to stop the spread of these Jesuit priests, paid for it with their lives. There is no way, Greg, that we should be accepting the coincidence that Adams and Jefferson died on the 4th of July within hours of each other. This is a famous calling card of assassins.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with James Monroe, who died on the 4th of July. Monroe reacted to the secret treaty of Verona, where Russia, Prussia, France, and I want to say Spain swore their allegiance to the papacy, to conquer the world for the papacy. And somehow, supposedly, James Monroe got wind of this and enacted the Monroe Doctrine as a counter, the great chessboard. And as a result, the Jesuits supposedly murdered him.
That's really interesting, because that was one of my questions for you, is how did the Jesuits get such a foothold in early America when the early founders were so on guard and so skeptical of the Jesuit order? But this makes a lot of sense. This is apparently how it's done. You obviously just kill some people.
They weren't. They weren't. Unfortunately, it's entirely possible that George Washington was a puppet of the Jesuits the entire time. We're all familiar with George Washington's connections to Freemasonry. Many apologists, and let me tell your audience, there is nobody that loves this country more than I do. So if I say things that seem un-American, I want you to know I'm trying to out malignant forces. I'm not trying to talk down. I spent 20 years in the military because I love my country. It's important for us to know as Americans who has hijacked this nation, possibly from the very beginning. George Washington was reputed to have a magnificent painting of the Virgin Mary in his home. His best friend was a Jesuit priest by the name of Leonard Neal, and it is well known that George Washington called Leonard Neal to his deathbed. In fact, a Roman Catholic website will tell you that George Washington died a Catholic because he called his best friend, Jesuit priest Leonard Neal, to his bedside.
Hmm.
Oh, my goodness. You go back to who owned Maryland, the colony of Maryland, Lord Baltimore, George Calvert, a Catholic, a devout Roman Catholic, got the toehold there. And the... Andrew White was the individual that owned the property that our White House was built on, a devout Roman Catholic. Many people, hey, what is the White House named after? Well, it's named after its color. It's white. No. It's named after devout Roman Catholic Andrew White.
Hmm.
That whole area, this is really creepy, and I just found this out recently. The area was deeded to a Catholic, a sheriff. Look this up, folks, on the internet. He is deed holder number 7. And if you don't have this information, you can't find it, write to me, johnny@johnnycirucci.com, and I will show you the deed holder for the property that our capital was built upon was a guy by the name of Francis White. And on September 23rd of last year, for the first time in American history, a Jesuit pope visited the White House, and his name was Pope Francis. I'm sorry, Francis Pope was the name of the individual. The sheriff of Maryland, Francis Pope, was the original deed holder number 7 in 1614, I think.
Hmm.
And we just had a visit where the entire Congress of the United States bowed before Pope Francis, the Jesuit Pope. So, America, who has conquered America from the very beginning? Let's look real quick at Abraham Lincoln.
Right.
Abraham Lincoln. Oh, my goodness. So we had a Catholic priest who went to Abraham Lincoln because he was being framed by a power play amongst Catholic circles. And Reverend Charles Chinnicky, who eventually his protest against the Catholic Church made him leave the Catholic Church. This is crazy. Greg, Charles Chinnicky, at that time, Father Charles Chinnicky, was being framed by Catholic authorities as having had sexual relations with women and so forth. And so he took this to a young lawyer named Abraham Lincoln. Do you know that Abraham Lincoln won Charles Chinnicky's case for him in this slander? And as a result, they became fast friends. And as Charles Chinnicky left the Catholic Church, he became extremely concerned with the machinations of the Vatican and the Jesuits and the dangers to the Lincoln administration. It eventually got to a point where Abraham Lincoln is quoted as having said, and Charles Chinnicky became a very close advisor, quoted Lincoln as saying, "The Jesuits are going to kill me, and they're behind the Civil War."
Damn.
Now, we all laugh and say, oh, that's ridiculous. That's ludicrous. Okay, so who killed Abraham Lincoln? It was a lone gunman, right? A lone gunman. Lee Harvey Oswald. No, wait a minute. Different wrong lone gunman. It was John Wilkes Booth, right? He was the only one involved. Oh, there's some other names there. We need to look that up. An entire family named Surratt, S-U-R-R-A-T-T, devout Roman Catholics. In fact, the matron of the family, Mary Surratt, had a boarding house, Greg. You know, I want to know how devout a Roman Catholic she was. She did not allow non-Catholics to become renters in her boarding house.
Damn.
Her son, John Surratt, was in training to be a Catholic priest. He was the co-conspirator. They actually came up with the plot at the Surratt home. I have found evidence that John Wilkes Booth himself was a secret Catholic. And here is the kicker. The supposedly Roman Catholics are hated enemies of Freemasons. The reality is quite the opposite. If Freemasonry ever had its own will, it was long ago destroyed by the Jesuit order, may not ever have had its own will. Today it's completely controlled, and some of the greatest examples I give are John Wilkes Booth, who is a quiet and secret Catholic and also a Freemason, a member of Albert Pike's Knights of the Golden Circle. So you have this Catholic Freemason cabal that led into the murder of Abraham Lincoln. And here's the kicker, Greg. We know that Abraham Lincoln was shot by Wilkes Booth, but what we don't know is that there are sources, and I have them cited in my book, that say John Wilkes Booth never died. He never died in the shootout that supposedly killed him.
I've heard that too.
He escaped and went west. One thing that we can say is an historical fact that fits right in with this is that co-conspirator John Surratt emigrated, left the country, and was helped by papal authorities. At some points, he disguised himself or was disguised by papal authorities as a Catholic priest. Do you know at some point he ended up going through Rome? He was there in Rome and then was in Egypt when he was captured and brought back. And John Surratt did survive. His trial was thrown out. So John Surratt, co-conspirator in the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, lived long after his trial. And we have sources that say John Wilkes Booth also survived, which really might tell you that not only are these forces powerful, they're powerful enough to make sure that their assassins, their hitmen, go unpunished.
Right, yeah. Again, no accountability.
This is connected. In 1866, these roots were incredibly clear. The implication that Rome and the papacy was behind the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and according to Lincoln's confidant, Charles Chinnicky, also behind the Civil War. Citizens were so upset that they demanded action from the puppets in Washington, D.C. As a result, they stopped the legation and brought back the ambassador from the Vatican in 1866. From then on until 1984, there was no connection, no political connection between the sovereign city-state of Vatican and the United States of America. There were no ambassadors. You know who changed that? Ronald Wilson Reagan. And you know who whispered in his ear to get it done? A Freemason by the name of Billy Graham.
Damn. So let me ask you a question here, because I've been pretty convinced by guys like Jim Mars that all the presidents who have been killed, Lincoln, Garfield, JFK, were all trying to subvert the currency control of the elite. Is there truth to that or no?
That's a partial truth. The currency control is a critical part, but it's a middle echelon. It's not the top echelon. The upper echelon is the papacy and the Jesuits. The middle echelon is extremely critical. The Federal Reserve was a sickening, treasonous coup carried out by the bankers. But just look at the connections of Knights of Malta in banking, particularly the Bank of America, created by a Knight of Malta. And that will tell you everything you need to know about who really controls the bank. Matter of fact, that also is brought out in that book, The Rockefellers and the Federal Reserve, their gold standard. I've got a copy of that. I'll give you the exact title. But we'll explain how. Oh my goodness, yeah. There's no doubt about it. Had the critical role. Listen, brother, our currency in the United States is a nickel of what it was worth in 1913.
Right.
After that despicable coup of the Federal Reserve, you can very easily get wrapped up in the truth of the coup of the Federal Reserve and lose the puppet masters who are above the Federal Reserve, which is the papacy, because and that's what they want you to do. They want you to get fixated on the symptoms and not the root causes.
Mm-hmm. They want you to stop on the second or third or fourth rung of the pyramid and never really reach that capstone.
And they're safe. And so if there's any uprising, whether it's an information uprising or something more strenuous than that, they're still safe. They can still control from behind the scenes and manufacture or manipulate the uprising. And boy, has that happened. That's the CIA's calling card right there. Mm-hmm. Is to take an uprising, wait till the people are really ticked, and then manipulate it and warp it and make it go in the direction they want it to go. And so they're perfectly safe. Oh, Greg, great example. Okay. Puts it all, wraps it all up together. You want to fight the machine, right? You want to go out and protest, but you want to do it anonymously. You're out in the protest. You're worried about a little mosquito drone coming in, taking a picture of your face. What do you go put on to cover your face?
That Guy Fawkes mask.
You put on a Guy Fawkes mask, don't you? Well, who's Guy Fawkes? Guy Fawkes is a Jesuit assassin. Guy Fawkes used to be Guido Fawkes, who was part of, remember, the 5th of November in 1605 was an attempt to murder the Protestant king of England, King James the First, James the Sixth of Scotland, by thoroughly covering the floor of the House of Lords in gunpowder, barrels of gunpowder, and taking out half the House of Lords in order to murder the Protestant king to gain back newly Protestant England for the papacy.
Man.
So how hilarious is it that if you want to go up and make a stand and fight the machine, you're going to put on the face of a Jesuit assassin? Oh, and by the way, what's been known as Guy Fawkes Day has been a protest since that time where an effigy of the Pope was burned, particularly by good English Protestants. It has so been disconnected from its historical accuracy, no one even knows. And would you believe, and again, this is easy for any of the audience to look up, George Washington, who did George Washington answer to? Do you know that George Washington stopped his soldiers from conducting Guy Fawkes Day, which is to burn the Pope in effigy? He actually told his soldiers they needed to be thankful for their help, the papacy was giving them. Kind of tells you who he answered to.
Yeah. Wow, man. This is quite a bit of information. And, you know, it is a different kind of history than we're used to hearing. Of course, we've discussed why that would be. But can you tell us a little bit about the Vatican hierarchy? Because one of the most interesting angles to me is the idea of a black pope, that we all see this schmoozing public figure of a pope and that we think is the boss, when really there's a dark and hidden hierarchy behind him that stays in the shadows. How much truth is there to that?
It's completely true. The Black Pope is called the Black Pope. He is the Superior General, a military title given to the commander of the Jesuit order. Our current commander, Superior General, is a guy by the name of Adolfo Nicholas, Adolf Nicholas, and good Spanish Jesuit, just like his founder, Ignacio Lopez. And he's called the Black Pope for two reasons. One is a superficial one because of the humble black priestly cassock they wear. But the reality is he's also called the Black Pope because of the frightening level of power that the Black Pope wields. He actually is in control of the Vatican and the papacy. Great example is what happened with Benedict XVI. Now, Benedict XVI was actually in tight with the Jesuits. He helped the Jesuit write Vatican II. But apparently he wasn't close enough. They wanted one of their own. And so they gave Benedict Joseph Ratzinger, who was a Nazi Hitler youth, gave him a deal he couldn't refuse and forced him to step down for the first time in 600 years so that one of their own, Jorge Mario Bergoglio, could step up and we would have a Jesuit pope for the first time in the history of the Holy Roman Empire in the world.
Yeah, that step down was really weird.
It was extremely weird, and I think it's a result of what we're doing right now, Greg. I think that the promulgation of this information has forced these literal Luciferians, they worship Lucifer, the bearer of light and of knowledge. They're all Gnostics, just like the Freemasons. They believe that he is Prometheus, the giver of light and knowledge, who was beat down by the gods for just trying to help with knowledge and information. White is black and black is white. That Jesus, he's the bad guy. Lucifer, he's the good guy. White and black. You see how they're juxtaposed like black squares on a Freemasonic floor.
Fair, man. Well said. And maybe this is a good place to call it in. We definitely went a little bit overboard, but you know, the joys of not being under someone else's schedule means we can do that, and it's not a big deal. And we might come from different philosophies, but at least we can unite around a common enemy. I think that's really all that matters, right?
Amen. Down with the system, brother. And listen, I love you, brother. I'm here for you anytime. If you ever want to revisit, there's so much more material. You ever want to revisit, I'm here for you, brother. I'll gladly move my schedule around and come talk to you again.
Right on. I appreciate that. So yeah, that pretty much does it for us. But before we really call it in, of course, your book is a massive, near 800 pages with all the sources and everything that you have in it. Remind the people where they can get that, hear your show, and keep tabs on what you got going on.
Yes, sir. You can pick it up on Amazon, or you can go directly to my website. It's johnnycirucci.com, JohnnyCirucci. You can write me at johnny@johnnycirucci.com. The program is Resistance Rising on Blog Talk Radio. All this stuff are buttons and links on my show, but you can go to Blog Talk and search for Resistance Rising. Go to Amazon and search for Illuminati Unmasked. Be right there for you. Contact me. I'm here. I'm very eager and continue to interact with my audience. I crowdsource intelligence, Greg. I love it. Mm-hmm. I have my own flying monkey squad of flying monkeys that go out and dig up. I tell them, what do you look at? You look at somebody's personal beliefs, their religion, their education, whether they're a member of a secret society. And boom, that's everybody in power right there. Dig up the dirt, send it to me, johnny@johnnycirucci.com.
Very cool, man. I do appreciate your time and the work you do. Johnny, keep fighting the good fight out there. All right, man.
Thanks, Krug. Love you, bro.